Thank you. Good evening. I've got two hats on at the moment. I'm the steward, and I'm also trying to lead worship at the same time. So this is my steward hat at the moment. I'd just like to welcome the Eco Group for coming to lead us in worship this evening. Mayday, mayday. The islands of the southern seas cry out. The rising tide overwhelms us.
God's people are called to action. Mayday, mayday. The farmers of Africa cry out. The climate is changing. Our crops are failing. And our children go hungry. God's people are called to action.
Mayday, mayday. Creatures of the forests and oceans cry out. Our species face extinction.
God's people are called to action. Mayday, mayday. Generations to come cry out. Act now, before it is too late for us. God's people are called to action.
Mayday, mayday. God, creator, lover of islands, farmers, forests, and oceans cry out. God of past, present, and future generations, listen, my people, listen to the cries of the earth. I am calling you to action.
We are God's people, called in God's name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Our first hymn is, if you're using your books, 239, and it is Sent by the Lord Am I.
Liz Delafield, and I go to church here at Dalstone Lane, and I'm part of the Circuit Eco Group with Stuart and Sue and a few other people who couldn't unfortunately be here today. I think because it's the bank holiday weekend, it's we've been a little bit depleted. But we've got, I think, the righteous remnant. That's what we call, isn't it? So, in November, we had a circuit service during COP26. So COP26 met in Glasgow in November to decide what the world's response should be to the climate crisis. All the scientists of any note, all the environmentalists, accept now that there is a climate crisis and there needs to be something done about it. As Christians, we should be front and centre of that, because we know that this beautiful planet has been entrusted to us by God. Now, since November, we had that service. What's happened in terms of our climate? To be honest, I don't think it's been an awful lot globally. I think the world's eye, understandably, has been on other things. And a lot of the actions that everybody said they were going to take at COP26 are happening very slowly, if at all. So I think now, today, May Day, did you get the joke? Yeah. May Day is a good day to spur them on to do some more and say, we need to take action now. This is important. The people of God think this is important and we want action now. So that call is to ourselves. It's to our churches, it's to our communities, it's to our political leaders. And this service is really thinking about how we act out that call. So that sounds exciting, doesn't it? So that's what we're going to do today. And over to Sue. Sue's going to tell you some ideas from COP26.
We did have a slot in this service which was supposed to be voices from the young, and unfortunately we couldn't identify any young people, although looking round I can definitely see a couple of younger people in the congregation, but you might want to sort of disappear under the floorboards at this point. Don't worry, you're not going to get pounced on. But as an alternative to that, I thought about all the sound bites and quotes that we heard last November in the lead up to COP26 and the things that were said at COP26. And some of those were said by young people. They were actually things said by people of all ages. Some of those were famous people, some of those you probably had never heard of before. And I've just picked out five quotes that I thought were particularly good. And I'm going to read them out. And if you think you know who said each of the quotes, then please shout out that person's name. I can almost guarantee that you will know two of the names. So be ready. Number one, responsibility rests with each and every country, and we must all play our part, because on climate, the world will succeed or fail as one. Thank you. Alex Sharma, who was president and still is president of COP26. Number two, this COP26 is so far just like the previous COPs, and that has led us nowhere. Yep, Greta Thunberg said that. Number three, failure's really not an option for my country.
Well, it's the lady who's the president of the Solomon Islands or something. If it starts
Okay, it's Tina Steggy, who is the Marshall Islands climate envoy. She was very, very prominent on the news of things coming from COP26. She is well worth looking up. But of course, she, coming from the Marshall Islands, is coming from one of the countries most affected by rising sea levels caused by climate change. So, Tina Steggy, look her up and see what she is continuing to say about the urgency of the problem. Then the fourth one, the animals are disappearing, the rivers are dying, and our plants don't flower like they did before. The earth is speaking. She tells us that we have no more time. No, it wasn't David Attenborough, but hold on to that thought. It wasn't David Attenborough. Opposite age almost of the opposite end of the age spectrum. You probably won't know this person's name, but you might know something about them. No, you mean Megan? Megan, whatever her name is. Yeah. No, it wasn't her. It's from somebody called Zai Suri, a youth leader from the Amazon rainforest. And I love that quote. The animals are disappearing, the rivers are dying, and our plants don't flower like they did before. The earth is speaking. She tells us that we have no more time. In other words, listen to the earth. And then the last one. In my lifetime, I've witnessed a terrible decline. In yours, you could witness a wonderful recovery. That's David Attenborough. And I think that's a wonderfully hopeful quote from David Attenborough. Now, I'm going to risk asking if any younger people wanted to add anything at this point. If not, there'll be a chance to do something later on. We'll move on.
Let us pray. This we know, the earth does not belong to us.
We belong to the earth.
This we know, all things are connected.
The blood that unites one family.
This we know. We did not weave the web of life.
We are merely a strand in it.
This we know. Whatever we do to the web,
we do to ourselves.
Let us give thanks for the gift of creation.
Let us give thanks that all things hold together in Christ. Amen.
Our next hymn is, Oh, the Life of the World. It is in your Singing the Faith hymn book 114, but the author's written some extra verses, but that you'll be able to see those on the screen.
Life of the world is the source of refreshes where justice is strong. All the life of the world is a promise, a blessing in the rain that renews, in the heat of the sun, in the heart that confesses and the act that expresses. All things and all people are one. Oh, the life of the world is the breath of our being. It is fragile and precious and offers a choice. Shall we share the earth wisely? Can we touch the earth gently? Will we listen to earth's silent voice? So give thanks for the life and give love to the Maker, and rejoice in the gift of the bright risen sun, and walk in the peace and the power of the Spirit till the days of our living are done.
A reading based on the Proverbs 8:1-12, 18-21. Wisdom is shouting out. Listen, wisdom is shouting out. She is making herself heard. She stands on the hilltops. She stands at the crossroads. She stands at the city gates. Don't miss her. What she says is important. Listen up.
I am speaking to you, humanity. I am speaking to everyone on earth. Are you immature? Come and learn to be mature. Are you foolish? Come and learn some sense. What I teach you is right and true. I hate lies. I will not mislead you. I will make things clear. My instructions and my teachings are more valuable than silver and gold. My experience is better than all the jewels in the world. I have knowledge and insight. My judgment is sound.
Listen, wisdom is shouting out. She is making herself known. She stands high on the hilltops. She stands at the crossroads. She stands in your path. Don't miss her. She will blow your mind. Listen now.
I have integrity and honor to gift you. What you get from me will be better than the finest gold, more glorious than the purest silver. I know where to walk. I follow the path of justice. I do what is right. Those who love me, those who learn from me, will fill their lives and houses with treasure.
Listen, wisdom is shouting. She is making herself heard. Wisdom is calling you out.
This is me now, Liz. I'm not wisdom anymore. So you don't have to take notice. That reading, as Stuart said, is based on the reading from Proverbs about the wisdom of God and how the wisdom of God calls us and sometimes shouts at us and stands in our path. And I was wondering, in these days of the climate crisis, what wisdom might be saying to us today. I'd like you just to spend a few moments now thinking about that with the people who are sitting on your table. What does wisdom have to say to us today about the world that we're living in and the climate crisis? So I'll give you a few moments with that, and then I'm going to invite people to share together what they think God's wisdom is saying to us today.
Woodley, it's Tress and Katie's husband's from Woodley, so Woodley's represented. Yeah, Hazelgrove. Is that the James? Yeah, because we want them to say back to us, don't we? Do we want them to say back to us?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right, thank you very much, everybody. I think...
...say something to me. Wisdom tells me to have hope rather than despair, because hope is a springboard for action. Wisdom tells me that God remains involved with what God created and inspires us all to be good stewards of the earth. Wisdom tells me to look at the youngest member of my family, my 2-year-old granddaughter, and to act in a way that protects her, that protects the future of her generation and generations still to come.
Right, who else wants to say that? Thank you for that, Sue. Who else would like to say something? Jeremy, do you want to?
Jeremy and I had quite a few thoughts, but we'll share the last couple. Wisdom tells us to think about what we buy and to recycle or reuse things if we can.
Thank you for that. Anybody else?
I don't know. Well, we had. We were talking about wisdom tells us to take action where you can, but it's also putting pressure on our governments in terms of laws and big businesses, so that there are many big decisions that need to... it's all part of the same conversation. And wisdom tells us to slow down and pause and think and question.
Just to add to that, to slow down and not jump onto the latest bandwagon and short fix for... climate change and things. We need to really question what is going to make the most impact. And we were saying, weren't we, it needs to address things like people's ability to live on very little money. You go for the cheapest option. We need to find a solution for that. And also, planting trees is brilliant, but the carbon is stored in the old forests and the old trees, and we need to stop the cutting down of those, even though we're, because the ones that we're planting now won't be storing masses of carbon for another 50 years or so. Yeah.
Thank you for that. Reverend Hamilton.
Sorry. Wisdom teaches me how little I know. And how little we know. And sometimes things are hidden that we need to uncover and become wise about.
Well, we talked very similar to Jeremy about consuming less, but we were conscious that could affect people's jobs. There are two sides to it. Anybody over here want to say anything? Deborah?
Well, we talked about living, the need to live more simply, but also to remember that this is a global issue. It's not just us. In fact, we're touched much less than the world.
Anybody else? Anybody over here?
I'm really sorry, we didn't have much hope on this table. It all seemed a bit depressing. But no, the thought we had was the Earth's resources are very precious, and we've heard that term custodianship a lot. But when you think about it in reality, it does mean everything that people have been saying about slowing down, thinking very carefully about what you use and how you use it. And we were talking about the recycling ideas and people reusing things and not being a throwaway society, very much because we're here and now, but there are people following us and we have to look after the world for them.
Anybody in the band? You want to stay out of the way? Okay, fine. Anybody over here want to say anything? Oh. No? Yes, Katrina.
I think perhaps what we wondered was what would actually give us a kick up the backside to make us do things. And I think it's that emotional involvement, the mention of thinking of our 2-year-olds or even 6-week-old grandchildren might be the thing that would get us going.
Anybody else? No? That's lovely. Thank you very much for all those
contributions. Are you going to do that? I think there's a lot that wisdom has to say to us today, so I think we'll continue to reflect on that with the rest of our service.
Our next hymn is Touch the Earth Lightly.
Our second reading is James chapter 2, verses 14 to 18. And in this passage, which is headed Faith and Deeds, James links faith with action. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds.
So, deeds, not words, as Emily and Pankhurst summarised St. James. Or a little more, little less conversation, a little more action, as Elvis put it. So a time for us now to think about the actions that we're going to take. I think we've talked quite a lot in other forums about things and other services about things we can do as individuals. I'm going to talk a bit now about what maybe we could do or are doing as a circuit that we can do collectively, because those things that we do collectively are a lot more powerful. First thing that we've already done as a circuit is we've sent an open letter to Alok Sharma, who's the president of COP26. He remains the president until COP27 happens, which is in Turin. Is it in Turin? I can't remember where it is this time. Or is that Eurovision? I don't know. But anyway, until the next one, he remains the president. So we've written to Alok Sharma, and this is what the churches in our circuit have to say. Dear Alex Sharma, this is an open letter for the Methodist Churches and the URC Methodist Partnerships of the United Stockport Circuit. We are writing to express our concerns about climate justice and ask for stronger and more immediate actions to move more swiftly towards the commitments made during COP26. In November, the world's eyes were on Glasgow. Yet everyone made strong, impassioned speeches about the importance of tackling climate change. Yet now it seems little has changed. Whilst our attention might, for good reasons, be elsewhere, this issue will not go away. The metaphorical comet is still on its collision course. Urgent action is needed. For example, urgent action is needed by our government in the following areas to enable us to meet our COP26 targets. Renewable energy. Funding research and development is needed, as well as training for the jobs to support the renewable energy industry. For example, tidal power is an underused resource. The government is currently putting considerable investments into fossil fuels, including fracking and a new coal mine in Cumbria. This should be diverted to renewables. Additionally, investment is needed to enable domestic users to convert to greener energy. At the moment, the costs of installing domestic renewable energy, for example, ground source heat pumps, are prohibitive for most people. The government, rather than increasing, has withdrawn some of the subsidies for solar panels. This needs to be coupled with action on better insulation to reduce our need for domestic energy use. The phasing out of fossil fuel vehicles. Considerable investment is needed to ensure the charging infrastructure is available for electric vehicles. Additionally, the government needs to work with the motor industry to bring down the costs of electric vehicles while ensuring the safety of those working in the supply chain of car batteries. Currently, incentives to install electric charge points in domestic homes are being withdrawn. Additionally, measures are needed to encourage and enable walking and cycling and investments made in better public transport. Without measures such as this, it seems unlikely that we'll be ready to meet our target of phasing out petrol and diesel vehicles by 2030. Financial support for poorer countries. Ensure that we are doing our bit to support the world's poorest communities in the global south, for both the effects of climate change and to develop their own clean energy infrastructure. The $100 billion a year climate finance agreement that was made in COP15 in 2009 is routinely missed. These countries have caused least damage in terms of their carbon emissions and yet are the worst hit from the effects of the climate crisis. This is not an exhaustive list, but illustrates that our country needs to invest in an urgent, robust, and organized plan to tackle the climate crisis. As the current presidential nation, we should be leading the way on this. As Christians, alongside other people of faith, love if more people will get on board. So if you'd like to be in the Circuit Eco Task Group, if you speak to myself or Sue or Stuart afterwards, then we will bite your hand off. So, not literally, but we'd love to have more people involved with that. So if that's something you think you'd like to do, they would love to have you along. So we have to agree an environmental policy. Again, that will be up to the circuit meeting to discuss that. And then the other thing we need to do is we need to have a certain level of churches that have eco church awards. You may see to your left a rather beautiful one on the wall. You could have one like that on the wall in your church. So
We've been on this process for quite a long time. Before it was called Eco Congregation, and we were delighted just this last year to finally been awarded our Silver Award. There's a lot of hard work gone into it, and it was quite a lot of things we had to do. But we were we feel we're really kind of hopeful that we're moving in the right direction, and it's something we're certainly going to continue with. So I know several of the churches are already registered for the Eco Church process, so thank you for that. To be a bronze Eco Circuit, we have to have at least 15% of our local... 10%, isn't it? Because it's, how many churches in this circuit? 12. Well, is it 11 to 12? What's that? 11 to, yeah, so it's 10% of our local churches... So that's 1.2, isn't it? so we need another 0.2. So we need another church, at least 10%. So we need one other with an award for a bronze, 20% if we want to be a silver Eco Circuit, or 40% if we want to be a gold Eco Circuit. So if your church is not already looking at Eco Church, then that would be a really good thing to do. We found it really helpful because it gives you loads of ideas and things to... It challenges you to think about different areas such as your building, your acts of worship, all the other things that you do, the management of your land, your outreach in the local community in terms of what you're saying about the environment and God's world and creation. So we found it's enlivened and helped our church in so many ways. It's been really good to be part of it. So I really, if you're not already, I really invite you to do that. So several of our, I think Katrina was over there before. She's still there. Katrina's part of our eco group, and she's also been taking the lead on making us a fair trade church as well. So you can talk to me, if you want to know about that process, talk to me or Stuart or Katrina, we'll tell you a little bit about how to start that off. We also need to look at the circuit, any buildings that belong to the circuit in terms of the sustainability, and ensure that environmental issues are embedded in the curricula of presbyterial and local preacher education and support. So that's another thing we might have to look at. We've got to make sure our finances are invested ethically and encourage greater environmental action collectively with our ecumenical partners. So there's quite a lot to do there. But I think it's worthwhile to go on this journey because it would really be a witness to how much we care for God's planet to be on that journey together. So if we're going to do that, whose job is it? Whose job is it to make this an eco circuit? Pardon? Val Rowlands, is it her job? Yeah. Val's really good on those things, isn't she? But I don't think she could do it on her own, could she, Jeremy? Yeah. So, as well as Val, I think it's everybody's got a job to do, haven't they? Yeah. So whether all of us, yeah. So everybody, all of us have got a job to do in that. So what I'm going to challenge you to do now is to think about your role within the church and think about what you could do to further our journey towards being an eco circuit. So maybe you help out at Sunday school and you could do something with the children. Maybe you're a musician. You could think about bringing that into your ministry. Maybe you've reached a time when you just like to be
quiet and think, and maybe you want to pray more, just to spend time in prayer, praying for Eco Circuit. Maybe you're on the property committee and you're thinking, you know, I think we could have some solar panels on our church. We could start generating our own energy. Or we really need to think about how we insulate our building better. We really need to look at the property aspect of Eco Circuit with or Eco Church with our church. So whatever that is, give you some time now. In a moment, we're going to play. It's a chant from Africa, and it's in Xhosa. Do I have any native Xhosa speakers here? No. Excellent. That means if we say it wrong, nobody will know. And it goes, the words are, Mayenze we tando yako. And it's from the Lord's Prayer. And it means, your will, O Lord, be done on earth. So we're just going to sing that repeatedly while we're thinking about what we can do to be part of Eco Circuit. Those people who are worshipping with us at home via the YouTube, you could do this as well. You could write down what you want to do as part of Eco Circuit and maybe send it in to somebody. Yeah? And when you've done that, if you bring your idea and place it around the globe as a symbol of your commitment to become part of our Eco Circuit. Oh, yeah, there's paper on your tables. You see that? What? Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Right, thank you very much for all those. Got some fantastic. We've got somebody, the community worker, wants to link with local groups for collaborative working and ensure all purchases fit with the Eco Church policy. Collect hard plastic tops for all the circuit. And somebody says to ensure that each service I lead makes reference to the need to consider the future of the planet. I've got loads of really good suggestions here, so I'm not putting them all out today. What I'd invite you at the end of the service is maybe come and have a look, come and collect yours and take it home as a reminder to be part of this and to do that. So thank you very much for those. Right, I invite you now all to stand because we're going to make a pledge, a promise together. We're going to make a pledge together to be part of this Eco Church journey. If you're comfortable to do so, if you're not, that's okay. So let's say together, we join with the earth and with each other to bring new life to the land, to restore the water, to refresh the air. We join with the earth and with each other to renew the forests, to care for the plants, to protect the creatures. We join with the earth and with each other to celebrate the seas, to rejoice in the sunlight, to sing the song of the stars. We join with the earth and with each other
to recreate human community,
to promote justice and peace, to remember that we are all children of the earth. We join with the earth and with each other. We join together as many and diverse expressions of one loving mystery for the healing of the earth and the renewal of all life. Amen. Our final hymn is called Creator God, Abundant Life, Your Mark. It might be new to many of you, but it's a familiar tune.
Life, your heart, you want to see.
thanks for the good earth.
Blessed be God forever.
Let us go out in unity with all who seek to preserve the earth.
Blessed be God forever.
Let us go out in the conviction that change is possible and climate disaster is not inevitable.
Blessed be God forever.
And the blessing of God the Creator, Christ the Redeemer, and the Spirit, the sustainer of all life, be with us and with all the creatures of the earth, now and always. Amen.
Right, home time.